Hi everyone, if you could just take your seat please and we'll get started. I have the great opportunity of introducing our next speaker for today, Paul Kengor. Dr. Kengor is a professor of political science at Grove City College and is the executive director of the college's conservative think tank, the Center for Vision and Values. A New York Times best-selling author of more than a dozen books, Dr. Kengor is also a visiting fellow at the Hoover Institution at Stanford University and a senior editor at the American Spectator. He has been a frequent contributor to MSNBC, C-SPAN, the BBC, and Fox News Channel, among others, and is a regular columnist for Town Hall and the American Spectator. He also has 8 children, so I'm sure you've gathered by this point that he doesn't have much free time. Dr. Kengor is an internationally recognized authority on several subjects, particularly President Ronald Reagan, the Cold War, communism, conservatism, and progressivism. You may have heard of the upcoming film, Reagan, the movie, starring Dennis Quaid and co-produced by Mark Joseph and Ralph Winter. The film is based on 2 of Dr. Kengor's books, The Crusader and God and Ronald Reagan. Dr. Kengor received his doctorate from the University of Pittsburgh's Graduate School of Public and International Affairs and his master's degree from American University School of International Service. I've actually had the privilege of knowing Dr. Kengor for quite a while, almost my whole life actually, and have taken his classes as well. I can tell you from firsthand experience that Dr. Kengor excels in firing off facts and dates off the top of his head at lightning speed, all while keeping the mood light and captivating the audience's attention. Many of my friends who attend other schools say their professors discourage diversity of thought and will penalize students' grades if they submit a differing opinion. This is not so for Dr. Kengor. I remember several times throughout the semester hearing Dr. Kengor say, "Come on, I'm sure someone has to disagree with me. If not, will someone at least play devil's advocate?" Dr. Kengor encourages classroom debate and wants students to arrive at conclusions through thoughtful discussion and research. Dr. Kengor is a frequent speaker for YAF, and we are so excited to have him here with us today. So please join me in welcoming one of America's greatest professors and writers, Dr. Paul Kengor.
Okay. Thank you, Mary. Appreciate it. Thank you, Mary. That was too kind. I've actually known Mary for about 20 years, basically her entire life. And in fact, they lived right down the street from us in Grove City. Her father, Lee Wishing, ran the Center for Vision and Values with me. And I mean, this is how well I've known her, how close we all are. My wife and Lee's wife, my wife Susan, and Lee's wife Dee Dee, were pregnant at the time with my son Mitch, who, if he's in this room, is not going to wave his hand right now, and also with Mary. And Lee always tells me, you know, if Mary would have been a boy, I was going to name her Mitch. So she's not Mitch, she's Mary. And but I've known her for 20 years. So it's very, very kind, very nice of her to introduce me. Thank you. So this topic that I have today is not very kind and not very nice. In fact, it's pretty ugly, it's pretty deadly. And it's called, I've got a PowerPoint slide as well because I want you guys to see these quotes, okay? And I don't even have to say this, but as I'm going through some of these, I know already you're gonna pick up your phone, take pictures of some of these quotes, and you should, because this is basically gonna be, first of all, I could do this talk for an hour, but I only have about 30, 35 minutes, and then I want to take your questions. But you could also call this what I'm not learning in my liberal university, okay? And this is kind of everything you want to know about Marx and communism that your professor with the bust of Karl Marx isn't going to be telling you about. And I've been giving talks for YAF for years along the lines of titles like, "Why is Communism Bad?" And I'll have students who will email me and say, "Could you please come to my campus to give a talk on why communism is bad?" Because my econ professor literally has a bust of Karl Marx in his office. So I go there and I give a talk kind of along these lines. And then Regnery a couple of years ago asked me if I would write the politically incorrect guide to communism. And I said, you know, I am a politically incorrect guide to communism. I'm your guy. So with that, here we go, a little shameless capitalist plug here for my books. But the if you want citations for some of this stuff and so forth, first of all, you could email me. I could send you the citations. But they mainly come from that book, Completely Incorrect Guide to Communism, my book Dupes, my book Takedown. I have Politically Incorrect Guide to Communism and Takedown here for sale. I have a few copies of Dupes. I don't have any of The Communist, which is about Frank Marshall Davis, right? More on him in a minute. All right, so what Marx and Engels wanted, this drives me crazy. I go to different campuses, and all the time I'll run into somebody who will say, "Oh, The Communist Manifesto is a pretty good book if you just read it. Talks about love and sharing and helping your fellow man." I'll say, "Oh, yeah. Have you read it?" "Well, you know, I've skipped around a little bit here and there." I'm like, "Come on, man, you haven't read it." Because if you actually read this, and you should read it, and it won't take long, very, very short. It's not like Das Kapital, which would take you weeks. All right, you could read this very, very quickly. No one who walks away from reading that book is going to say, "Wow, that was a pretty good book. I think we should do that." Which is why I think, too, a lot of Marxist professors don't actually have their students read Marx, right? Because then they wouldn't become Marxist students. So it opens up, this book written in 1848, "A Specter is Haunting Europe, The Specter of Communism," which is a good phrase, specter. Good choice of words there. And there's a line in there where they say, "The entire theory of the communists may be summed up in the single sentence, abolition of private property." Well, you know, kind of says it all, doesn't it? Abolition of private property. And right there, anybody with a cell phone who likes their stuff, right, who wants a house, a big house, whatever. Right there, that's, you know, red flag, pun intended, right? Right? But the entire theory may be summed up in a single sentence, abolition of private property. And it's not like they then later say, "Well, we didn't really mean that." They double down on it repeatedly throughout the book. "You are horrified at our intending to do away with private property." And then what do they say? "Well, no, we didn't mean that literally." No, precisely so, that is just what we intend. That's exactly what we intend to do. All right, got it. Marx said that communism represents the most radical rupture in traditional relations. Here's another thing. These guys weren't tinkering around on the edges. I mean, they knew that what they were doing was truly revolutionary. This is a totalitarian ideology that really seeks to fundamentally transform human nature, okay? Marx said that his views on property, he acknowledged, quote, "stood contrary to the social and political order of things." Indeed, they did. This is one of my favorite phrases. It's awful favorite phrase, right? But communism seeks to abolish the present state of things. Wow. I think that's a good statement for progressivism as well. All that you really know, especially about secular progressivism, is that they're always changing. They're against whatever is in the past. There's no moral absolutes, which is completely unlike conservatism, which believes in first things, permanent things, moral absolutes, right? A set of basic definitions of basic things. Progressives believe that they're always progressing toward the truth. They're always changing. They're always evolving. Which is why their definition of marriage in 2015 for a Democrat or a liberal was completely different from where it was in 1995 on the Defense of Marriage Act and Bill and Hillary Clinton. And they will have a completely different view of it in 2035 and then in 2055. And if you ask them right now, what would be your definition of it in 2038? The best answer would be, "I don't know. I'll tell you when we get there." Because they're always evolving, they're always changing. You never know where the goalpost is. The close of the manifesto: "Communists everywhere support every revolutionary movement against the existing social and political order of things." Now that's a significant statement. You guys should read the other side. Read everything. go to Communist Party USA's website, cpusa.org. Check it once or twice a week. They don't change the content that much. People's World, which is the successor publication to the Daily Worker, read that. And the one thing that you'll see is they're always casting the net, reaching as wide as they can to support any revolutionary movement that they can that involves changing the present state of things. So they make the most unlikely alliances sometimes, but if they want to ally with a group that wants to redefine something that involves changing the way things have always been, they'll be there with them. And it's really right out of the manifesto. The communists disdain to conceal their views and aims. They openly declare that their ends can be attained only by the what? Forcible overthrow of all existing social conditions. Wow. That's no small thing. Marx called for, this is one of his letters, 1843, ruthless criticism of all that exists. These words like all, everything. Ruthless, forcible overthrow. Not a pretty good book if you just read it. Marx and Engels had a 10-point plan in the Communist Manifesto. Point number one, abolition of property and land, application of all rights. This is right out of the book. Two, a heavy progressive or graduated income tax. When did we get our heavy progressive or graduated income tax? When did it first become permanent? Anyone know? 1913, right? We had to amend the Constitution. Which amendment? 16th. And even then, the top rate was like 7% on people making like over $1 million a year. FDR took that top rate up to 94%. Okay, but they were talking about this back in 1848. Tell this, number three, to some of your friends who like Marx or have good things to say about communism. Abolition of all right of inheritance. How'd you like that? Basically, when your parents die, the money doesn't go to you or the house or the property. It goes to Uncle Sam or Big Sis or wherever it goes to, so they can redistribute it for benevolent purposes. Four, centralization of credit in the hands of the state by means of a national bank. That's number five, actually. I didn't list all 10. Six, centralization of means of communication and transport in the hands of the state. I mean, imagine taking all communication services and all transport and turning them over to the state. Railroad, shipping, trucking, communications, media. Look at this one. This is one of my favorite. Gradual abolition of all the distinction between town and country by what? By a more equitable distribution of the population over the country. Think about what that means. You're going to redistribute people? It's not enough to redistribute their property. You want a more equitable distribution of the population. That means you have to take people and force them out of their houses that you're going to take and put them in a more equitable district in the countryside, wherever you want to put them. You ever see the beginning of the movie, The Killing Fields, Cambodia? They're all being emptied out of the main city. They're being equitably distributed. And I've had socialists and Marxists say, well, the beginning of The Killing Fields, I would never advocate that. Well, what do you mean? They're going by the book. They're doing what Marx and Engels said. 10, free education for all children in public schools, which is one of the first things the Bolsheviks did. Took all schools away from the Russian Orthodox Church, banned all home education, and put everybody in government schools. Had to put everybody in there where they could be controlled. Now, if you're wondering, I mean, Marx and Engels that dumb? Didn't they realize that this would require despotism to do this? No, they got it. Of course, in the beginning, this cannot be effected except by means of despotic inroads. I mean, my six-year-old daughter, Gianna, could tell you, Daddy, they're going to have to kill people to do this. Yep. People aren't just going to lay down and say, oh, yeah, just take my inheritance, take my property, do what you want with my children, whatever else, go for it. Yeah, no problem. People aren't going to do that. What they said about home education and religious education, look at this one. Do you charge us with wanting to stop the exploitation of children by their parents? To this crime, we plead, no, we don't want to do that. We plead guilty. Guilty. Yes, that's exactly what we want to do. You got it. Marx and Engels on race. Got your cameras ready? You won't be learning this in Poli-Sci 101 at Progressive U, where they're focused on race all the time, right? Where they want to know every single member of the Confederacy or founding father who had a slave, where they're tearing down statues everywhere, where if they could find one bad thing Donald Trump said somewhere along the way or whatever, they use that to absolutely crucify the guy. But they never tell you what Margaret Sanger said with her Negro Project, or when she spoke to the Silver Lake, New Jersey chapter of the KKK in May 1926, which she writes about on pages 366 to 367 of her 1938 autobiography. They don't talk about any of that. They don't tell you what Woodrow Wilson said. No, they want to put those people on Mount Rushmore. They look past all of this. Here's what Marx and Engels said, and I won't read the quote, but you can read it for yourself. These are some of the words that they used. Look at this to Engels regarding their friend Ferdinand LaSalle, deducing exactly his lineage and his biology, his ethnicity, and what exactly that meant about him. Marx had a son-in-law, Paul Lafargue, who was partly Cuban, and so because of that, Marx called him the gorilla or negrillo. That's what he called him. By the way, Paul committed suicide in a suicide pact with Marx's daughter, one of two of Marx's daughters who committed suicide. Wasn't exactly the greatest dad or a father-in-law, for that matter. Here's another one. Here's Engels referring to Marx's son-in-law. He deduced that Paul possessed, quote, 1/8 or 1/12. Again, I won't read this stuff because it's very offensive. And he was running as a political candidate for a district in Paris which contained a zoo. And so Engels gave this letter of recommendation, this comment for Paul as to why he would be particularly well-suited for that position. Down the road from me in Grove City College, which is about an hour north of Pittsburgh, is Carnegie Mellon University, where this year they are celebrating the bicentennial of the birth of Karl Marx, who they're referring to as the great man. And they have about a dozen different presentations. None of them will have any of this kind of information. None of it. They don't talk about any of it. There's Marx on Jews. From his writing on the Jewish question. Marx was actually an ethnic Jew, which makes this really odd. What is the worldly cult of the Jew, wrote Marx, haggling. What is his worldly god? Money. Money is the jealous god of Israel before whom no other god may exist. The bill of exchange is the actual god of the Jew. I mean, this is like Nazi stuff. The Jew, said Marx, had become impossible. The emancipation of the Jews in the final analysis is the emancipation of mankind from Judaism. You won't learn any of that. You won't learn any of that at Progressive U. Marx and Lenin on religion. Religion, said Marx, is the what? Opiate of the masses. He also said, in a quote not as well known, communism begins where atheism begins. Former student of mine, Sean, at a private school in the Cleveland area, told me about a new teacher that they got fresh out of a university in central Pennsylvania who told them that as Christians, they should be communists because the Bible talks about sharing. after all. If Marx had been there, he would have said, "You, son, are an idiot. Communism begins where atheism begins. You cannot be a communist Christian," he would tell him. Lenin said, "All worship of a divinity is a necrophilia." You guys know what that means? Tell your parents at the YAF conference you learned what necrophilia is, right? Sorry about that. Ron, Kimberly, Pat. "There is nothing more abominable than religion. Nothing more abominable than religion." War on the Family, Marx wrote to Engels, "Blessed is he who has no family." It's a curious twist on the Beatitudes. I think Jesus left that one out, right? And they actually say right in the manifesto, "Abolition of the family!" exclamation mark. Even the most radical flare up at this infamous proposal of the communists. In 1848, abolition of the family was already an infamous proposal of the communists, which is why people hated communism back then. All right, 1917, the Bolsheviks take over. Who are those three? Stalin, Trotsky, and Lenin. Yeah, Lenin and Trotsky, all right. Communism immediately goes global because that's what it was intended to be. Marx and Engels finished the Communist Manifesto by saying, "Workers of the world, unite." And they said this from the very beginning. "It is in our interest and our task to make the revolution permanent, not only in one country, but all the leading countries of the world," because they launched the revolution not just to take over Russia, Russia is what they could take, but exclusively counting on world revolution. They wanted the whole world to be communist. And look at this bottom quote here from Lenin, March 1919. "We live not only in a state, but in a system of states, and the existence of the Soviet Republic side by side with the imperialist states is what? Yeah, we could all learn to get along, right? Unthinkable. In the end, either one or the other will hold hands and sing Kumbaya, will conquer. And before this result, a series of horrible conflicts between the Soviet Republic and the bourgeois states is unavoidable." They advocated violence, they wanted violence, they were counting on violence, they were counting on war, it was unavoidable. There would be horrible conflicts. They were never content just to screw up Russia. They wanted this all over the world, which is why our Congress was concerned about it and would ask people questions like, "Well, are you now, or have you ever been a member of the Communist Party? Are you working for the Soviet Union in the Comintern?" That's why Congress wanted to know, because of this. And your professor will say, freedom of speech. They were just a bunch of good liberal progressives hounded by Joe McCarthy. It was so unfair. They just wanted to practice their politics. No, there was an insidious, dangerous agenda behind this. They established the Comintern, which would be the organization that would spread communism around the world in March 1919. And America got its Communist Party established in September 1919 in where? Chicago. Two most radical cities in America are not San Francisco, not Berkeley, New York and Chicago. Cultural Marxism, classical Marxism, I'm gonna have to skip this, I hate to, but I have to, because I'm limited on time. All right, so they bring it to America. They eventually, Communist Party USA has been the party in America for 100 years now, going back to, almost 1919. Here is the loyalty oath that they swore when they joined Communist Party USA. Look at this. This was from the 1930s when Stalin was running the Soviet Union. "I pledge myself to rally the masses to defend the Soviet Union. I pledge myself at all times to be a vigilant and firm defender of the Leninist line of the party, the only line that ensures the triumph of Soviet power in the United States." The head of Communist Party, William Z. Foster, wanted a Soviet America, as he called it. Langston Hughes, who's reading Langston Hughes? Who's read Langston Hughes? Yeah, he's almost required reading now in public schools, where they strictly portray him on civil rights and nothing else. I didn't mention any of this stuff. You know, Langston Hughes said this? Put one more S in the USA to make it the USSA. That's what it'll be when we're through with it. The Hollywood 10, you'll learn about this at Progressive View. Ah, they were just a bunch of progressives being hounded by Joe McCarthy, who was so mean. First of all, they testified before the House Committee on Un-American Activities. McCarthy was a what? Senator. This is nowhere near any of these guys. This was October 1947. There, show this to your professor. Say, but professor, weren't all 10 of them actual, like, literal card-carrying members of the Communist Party? That's their numbers. We had them all in October 1947. They had all swore a loyalty oath to Stalin's Soviet Union. They were committed Soviet patriots. Some other famous American communists that you've probably never heard of, Frank Marshall Davis, Barack Obama's mentor in the 1970s. They referred to the party underground in Hawaii as the church. His Communist Party USA number was 47544. We have a 600-page FBI file. He was listed on the FBI's security index, which meant that if a war broke out between the United States and the Soviet Union, Obama's mentor could be placed under immediate arrest. He was called to the Senate to testify on his Soviet activities in December 1956, and he pled the fifth. Mr. Davis, are you now, have you ever been a member of the Communist Party? I plead the Fifth Amendment to the Constitution. But this is so, what's so appalling about this is they would wrap themselves in the US Constitution, which would have been the first thing that they torched when the USA became the USSA, because they would have followed the Soviet Constitution. And freedom of speech, press, assembly, property, everything else would have went right out the window, right up in flames. Here's some other American communists. That's Julius and Ethel Rosenberg. They were executed as atomic spies in 1953. And if any of you live in New York, make sure that you celebrate on September 28, 1915. It was established Ethel Rosenberg Day of Justice in New York City, which was created by the New York City Council. There's another famous American communist, Lee Harvey Oswald, who is holding copies of The Daily Worker and The Militant right next to the rifle that he used to blow out the brains of the President of the United States, which he did on behalf of his love of Cuba and the Soviet Union. Others, Angela Davis, who is the most famous American female communist. Now you can see Comrade Angela there at the bottom meeting with Erich Honecker, who built the Berlin Wall. They're giving her an award in the 1970s. She's very pleased by that. There she is meeting with Fidel Castro at the very bottom. And above that, if any of you were there, she was one of the speakers at the Women's March in Washington in January 2017, the day before Donald Trump was inaugurated. So the sea of young women wearing those pink hats, cheering for Comrade Angela, as she talked not about Marx and Lenin and Marcuse and cultural Marx. She's not going to do that. She's not dumb. She talked about gay rights, immigration, flora, fauna, ecology, climate change. She knows what to do, right? She knows what to do. She knows the right buttons to push. She ran on the Communist Party USA presidential ticket in 1976 and 1980 as the vice president. By the way, the head of that ticket was Gus Hall. Anyone know who voted for that ticket for president? Maxine Waters. I don't know. That's an interesting question. I'd like to know. But I wouldn't be surprised. John Brennan, Obama's CIA director, who's really after President Trump right now, he voted for Gus Hall for president of the United States. He voted for the head of Communist Party USA. To be, you know, a choice between, like, you know, Carter, Reagan, you know, this Gus Hall, of all things. So anyway, she was one of five honorary co-chairs of the Women's March. Some famous 60s comrades, there's Bill Ayers and Bernardine Dorn. Mark Rudd, one of the founders of SDS, who shut down Columbia in 1968. They formed the Weather Underground and became fugitives escaping the FBI in the 1970s. Bill Ayers famously said, "Guilty as sin, free as a bird. Isn't America a great country?" After that, after they served no prison time whatsoever, they all went into what else? Education. Bill Ayers is the University of Illinois, Chicago Education Department, got his PhD from Columbia Teachers College. He writes books on teaching social justice for Columbia Teachers College. Bernardine is a childcare advocate at Northwestern University School of Law. All right, meet Che and Fidel, two vicious commie thugs who wanted to blow up the world. I could give an hour just on these two guys. I don't know what they're lighting there on the left. I think it might be a dynamite. I'm not exactly sure what that is. I'm watching my clock. These two guys actually wanted to launch the nukes in October 1962, which would have unleashed nuclear Armageddon. Hundreds of millions of people would have died in the nuclear exchange. Hundreds of millions, especially as we took out Cuba, as the Soviet Union hit the US, as we hit the Soviet Union. Nikita Khrushchev got the missiles out of Cuba when he was told by his advisors, these two guys in America, who 20, 30 years from now, American college students are going to be wearing a picture of one of the guys in their t-shirts, these two guys actually want to use the nukes. But that would lead to Armageddon, World War III. They know it. Che wants to pull the temple down on his head, as one of the Soviets put it. And the Soviets said, we see you want to die beautifully. We don't want to die beautifully. So they had a midnight meeting on a Sunday at the Kremlin. And Nikita Khrushchev said, get them out. Get the missiles out. Get them out now. Now, 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 get them out. Get them out of there. These guys are madmen. That's why the missiles came out. Che ran the execution pit, La Cabana, and actually did some executions himself. Had the wall removed from his office so he could watch executions when he couldn't be there, present for it. He described himself to his wife as bloodthirsty. This is according to the Black Book of Communism, the Harvard University Press book. From 1959 to 1999, Fidel took over in 59. Approximately 100,000 Cubans attempted to swim to Florida or get on anything they could that floats. And we know at least a third of those, maybe as high as 40,000, drowned and died. Cuba is a surreal island that doesn't have boats because the boating industry is banned and controlled. The fishing industry is banned. Ask anybody who lives down there, they don't eat fish. They can't get fish because people aren't allowed to fish because fishermen holding the fishing pole jump in the water and start swimming. Swimming is banned on the beaches. That's how crazy it is. Compare 100,000 to this number, zero. That's the number of Americans, including your college professors who talk about what a wonderful place Cuba is for education and healthcare. That's the number of Americans who've tried to swim to Cuba since 1959. Only one way does the direction go. All right, I'm almost out of time here, but I want to give you the butcher's bill here. The number of people killed by communist governments. According to the Harvard University Press book, The Black Book of Communism, which was published in 1999, the figure is about 100 million. That's Vladimir Lenin today. That's him today. They re-embalm his body periodically. Martin Mollia of Cal Berkeley called it the most colossal case of political carnage in history. So which country killed the most deaths? China, which that says 65 million. It's probably more like 70 million. And note that the number there for the Soviet Union is only 20 million. Alexander Yakovlev, who was Gorbachev's chief reformer, who was given the job in the 1990s of counting the skulls, published a book with Yale University Press on this called A Century of Violence in Soviet Russia. He said Stalin alone killed 60 to 70 million. So you take just those two countries, probably actually get 140 million. A sense of comparison. That would be Hitler killed about 10 million, including about 6 million Jews. And then another 4 million, what he called undesirables, misfits, gypsies, Slavs. So it dwarfs what Hitler did. Take the total killed in World War I and World War II, combined, double them, and only then are you getting close to the number of people the communist governments killed or are responsible for the deaths of in the 20th century. And there's still places like China and North Korea and Cuba where the numbers keep going. All right, I got to wrap this up, but I wanted to hit one last thing. Oh, that's a West Point cadet with a picture of the man who called America the great enemy of mankind. We will strangle those hyenas. By the way, I should give you some of Che's quotes about race. Those are real nice. One in four Americans believe that George W. Bush killed more people than Joseph Stalin. And everybody likes to dump on millennials. The number for millennials in that survey is about the same as the general population. Oh, yeah, Bush killed, hell, 75, 80 million, didn't he? Last thing. You guys probably hear this a lot. And I could do a full hour just on this, but I'm going to wrap up. Last slide. I'm not a communist or a socialist. I'm a social democrat. I'm a democratic socialist. I'm a progressive. Well, Lenin, Trotsky, and Stalin were part of the Russian Social Democratic Labor Party, which in 1903 met for 2 weeks in Brussels and London, and then split into the majority, the Bolsheviks, and the minority, the Mensheviks. Herbert Marcuse, one of the leading founders of the Frankfurt School of Cultural Marxism, the mentor to Angela Davis, called himself a social democrat. Go to People's World, again, which is the website, the publication for American communists. You are far more likely to see them refer to themselves not as communists or Marxists or Leninists, but as progressives. The Progressive Party in 1948 ran Henry Wallace as president. It was totally controlled by American communists. So they use that word a lot of times. In fact, they use it a lot of times to hoodwink and dupe genuine liberal progressives who don't know that they're being used. Like if Angela Davis was standing at that women's march, she would say, "How many of you are progressives? Woo-hoo!" You know, a bunch of them would say that. But then she would say, "Well, I'm a communist, but I'm going to pretend to be." You know, they don't say that. "I'm a progressive too. Yay!" That's what they do. Right now, the largest socialist organization in the United States, and this is very relevant, is it not, to what's going on right now, is the DSA, the Democratic Socialists of America. Go to their website and read it and see what they believe. Because right now, they are running candidates throughout the country, including who? Yeah, Ocasio-Cortez, right? And two in my backyard in Pittsburgh, Summer Lee, Sarah Inamorato, who beat two traditional Democrats. And by the way, they're in very, very liberal districts, most of these people. They're not even going to have a Republican opponent in the fall. They beat the traditional Democrat. They're in. Democratic Socialists of America claim they now have about 40 to 50,000 members. Communist Party USA, at the height of its membership in the 1930s, had 100,000. CPUSA today claims they have about 5,000. So this is where people are going, to the socialist side, democratic socialism, as they're calling it. All right, so I'm over my time. I need to stop and take some questions while I still have time to take questions. All right, thank you. Hi.
I go to Georgetown University, where we strangely use Marxist theory of history in our English, government, and theology classes, just to name a few, which really, yeah, it surprised me, but what I want to know...
I knew you were going to say English. I expect that. In fact, yeah. The Carnegie Mellon, the people that are organizing the Marx Conference, are people who teach critical theory in the English departments, not being done by the poli-sci and econ people, history people, they know better. But at Georgetown, even the theology folks?
Well, what they claim is that we're using his, historical materialism as a lens that's somewhat harmless to look at these different religious movements in the past. And
I have a better idea. How about using Jesus?
Right, right.
Or even one of the 265 popes, right? I mean, you have to use Marx, of all things.
Wow. So how do you suggest that I refute that it's a harmless lens through which we can look at the past?
Yeah, I have a separate presentation on this. I'd love to come there and give it. I mean, we can invite the professors. But it's called the Catholic Church in Communism. There's been no other organization in history that has so consistently eviscerated communism like the Catholic Church. Pope Leo XIII, who did Rerum Novarum, you know, practically wrote the book on social justice and labor and so forth. Pope Pius IX, 10th, 11th, 12th, even Pope Francis said Marxism is wrong. I mean, so there's a long line of popes, leaders of the church. Divini Redemptoris, the 1937 encyclical. Encyclical after encyclical, statement after statement, they found probably nothing more damaging. Divini Redemptoris, the 1937 statement, described communism as a satanic scourge. So you might want to tell the professors, you know, the church actually officially described communism as satanic. They said, this isn't just bad or evil. This is like literally from Satan. This is like out of the pit of hell. All right, you know, the Satan gave you communism as well as Marx. So I would tell him that that's not an appropriate lens. And I can give you all kinds of material on that. Talk to me.
Okay, thank you.
All right, sure.
Thank you. Hello, Dr. Kengor. I'd like to thank you for being here today. It was a wonderful talk. My name is Chase Dudek. I attend Rider University. I'm a political science major. And I have a professor who is, well, I had him previously, who was not a Marxist. He was left of center, but and made us read the Communist Manifesto, and which, go figure, he wasn't a communist, so he made us read it. And I asked him, I said, what do communists say when someone who is not a communist says communism or socialism does not work because it goes against human nature?
Right.
And he said, well, their response is, and this was not him speaking for his opinion, he was not a Marxist, he was saying, they say it's not in our historical consciousness or some crap like that,
yeah,
that we be naturally selfish. I don't mean that in a bad sense, but naturally selfish beings. And I was wondering what your take on that was. And
yeah, well, I would say this. First of all, the main problem with it is that it does get human nature wrong. And I mean, once you screw that up, right, once you've misunderstood human nature. In fact, the previous question, John the 23rd, Pope John the 23rd, who those liberal theology professors at Georgetown will love that guy, they just canonized him. And also Pope Benedict the 16th, they all said that the main problem with Marxism was that it got human nature wrong. There's nothing more, okay, so think about this. The entire communist theory may be summed up in the single sentence, abolition of private property. I mean, private property is the most basic fundamental right. I mean, the Declaration of Independence talked about which three inalienable rights? Life, liberty, pursuit of happiness, which was based on the Lockean tradition, which also said property, right? Property was considered an inalienable right as well. One of the Ten Commandments is thou shalt not steal. It implies that people have property. From the cave to the courthouse, I mean, people of the most primitive tribes have had private property. And you can't really organize a world and a society without letting people own things, because then they create from those things that they own, and then they better themselves and the society around them. So if you get all of that, if you start off trying to abolish that, you don't even need to read another page. You just look at it and say, this is never going to work. And so they got that wrong, and then everything else flowed from that. So I don't know if I answered your question.
Yes,
okay.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Sure.
Hi, Dr. Kengor. My name is Jacob Viviano from the University of Michigan. And the question I had for you is, when we're talking with people about these ideas that have killed so many throughout the 20th century, what is the best way to connect the 100 million or more dead with the ideas that they romanticize about right now? Because there's a clear disconnect. People like to separate the ideas from the deaths. What's the first thing to do to connect them and to attack back so these ideas do not keep coming back throughout the future?
Yeah, and I wrote a very short piece you can get easily for the Wall Street Journal in May on the 200th anniversary. And I quote a Marxist biographer who's typical of a lot of these people. And they'll say, it's not the ideas right? It's the people who implemented the ideology. But all you have to do is read the ideas and the people who implemented the ideology to see they didn't get it wrong at all. I mean, you implement these ideas and these are the natural consequences. That 10-point plan of Marx and Engels, I mean, Lenin and Stalin did all of that immediately. Read Lenin on the State and Revolution. It's often referred to as Marxism-Leninism, right? And Lenin goes through there and interprets Marx, and he believes that he has Marx down exactly right. No, the implementers of Marx got Marx exactly right, which is why it's blown up the way that it has. And otherwise, you'd be able to name, one communist country that's worked out. You can't even name one. I mean, you ought to be able to name 100, right? If it's not really the ideology, or at least a dozen, a handful. There's not one. And you find out, too, again and again and again, they never hold free and fair elections. The Castro brothers would have the embargo lifted back in 1962 if they just held free and fair elections. Why don't they? Because they know they would lose. Because people never vote for this stuff. And if they did, they wouldn't vote them back in.
Hi, my name is Andrew Sturman from University of Huntsville, Alabama. But I'm from Pennsylvania, go Steelers. And my question to you is, whenever I ask self-proclaimed communists or even socialists, you know, where has communism worked? And they always point to like small settlements and just like small communities.
Right.
And they say like, you know, communism works here because they're trying like the purest form of it.
Right.
You know, like, what is the best way to refute that? Because so far what I've looked at, there's nothing that really goes against what they're saying.
Yeah. And that's a very common thing where they're completely wrong. I mean, you'll hear them refer to communities, even religious orders, right? Where they're, but that is more communal, communitarianism, sharing, people getting along with a common idea. But if you look at what they're actually doing in these groups, people even say, well, it works at home, right? Among a household. But none of those groups are doing Marxism-Leninism. They're not doing communism. They're not following the points of the Communist Manifesto. They don't have a war on religion that they're pursuing, or where they're, you know, talking about the abolition of the family, or trying to ban all private property. So whatever's going on there that's working, it's not communism. So people can work things out in a communal way, but they're not engaging in communism.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hi, my name is Anna, and I go to Miami-Dade. My grandparents are from Cuba, and a lot of countries in South America have been influenced by the Castros.
Yes.
And now there's a new president of Mexico who's kind of a Bernie Sanders type. Do you think he's poses like the same kind of threat as Castro and Che Guevara? And if so, what does that mean for the United States having them right below us?
Well, it's a great question. I don't know enough about the current leader in Mexico, but if you want to look at something that the left is very excited about, look at Venezuela. Mm-hmm. And Venezuela is what Hugo Chavez and the current leader refer to as 21st century socialism. If you Google that, the first thing that'll pop up is a Wikipedia entry. And 21st century socialism is a phrase coined by Hugo Chavez. And it was influenced, it's a funny thing about the left, when I was in college undergrad, they still use this phrase, dwems. You guys know what a dwem is? Dead white European male, right? Right, those are bad guys. What's funny that the left actually loves dead white European males when they're named Marx, Engels, Marcuse, Wilhelm Reich, the Frankfurt School, all these other people. But the 21st century socialism was influenced by a German theorist. And when you go through it and you actually read it and see what they're doing, it doesn't look very different from 20th century communism. And maybe the difference might be just simply a matter of degree. They won't take 100% of your property, but they'll take 75% of it. They won't nationalize every single industry, but they'll nationalize half of them. So they always think that by, you know, going not quite that far, that maybe it'll work out. Another thing too, I know I'm running out of time, I gotta stop, but they, always understand this, in Marxist theory, socialism is part of the process. You go from feudalism to capitalism to socialism and then eventually to full-blown communism. So socialism is a transitionary step or phase on the way to full-blown communism. So it's part of it. That's part of it. Do I need to stop? Okay, I got to wrap up. I'm out of time. Thank you, guys.
Kengor, everyone. All right, we're going to take a very short, about a 5-minute break, but please try to stay in the room if you can. Otherwise, take a 5-minute break. Thanks, guys.